Welcome to the third Wealthy Boomer interview with Dr. Moshe Milevsky of the York University's Schulich School of Business. Welcome back, Moshe.
Thank you.
Again, you've written a new book called Are You a Stock or a Bond? And previously you wrote a book on, actually it was on insurance logic, it was called. And I think that was where you really put out your thesis about longevity insurance and annuities. Last segment we talked about Manual Life Income Plus, and you told me in between it's now sold $5 billion. To what extent is that product and its competitors a form of longevity insurance?
I think a GMWB, which is an acronym for a guaranteed minimum withdrawal benefit, is a new class of products that protects you against a number of retirement risks in one package. It used to be that if you wanted to protect against longevity risk, which is the risk of outliving your time horizon, your planning time horizon, the only thing you could buy was an immediate annuity, a single premium immediate annuity or a variable immediate annuity. That was the only thing you could buy to protect against longevity risk. If you wanted to protect against sequence of returns risk, the market's going down at the worst possible time, you could buy maybe a put option from an options exchange, you could buy an ultra short bear fund, but you couldn't hedge longevity risk. And if you wanted to protect against inflation, you had to buy inflation-linked bonds, but you couldn't protect against longevity. What these products are doing is they're together combining one product that'll hedge against a number of risks that are unique to retirees. One of the risks is the longevity risk, the risk that they outlive the mortality tables that they've planned on. So we tell people to plan on a 25 or 30 year retirement, but there is a probability, especially for a couple, that they exceed those numbers, high 90s, perhaps even 100s. Right now in Canada, there are 5,000 people that have breached the age of 100, and we don't know what this is going to look like going down the road. And if you reach that very advanced age, you may end up with not enough funds to sustain retirement. One of the world's oldest women just passed away in Quebec, Julie Bertrand. She passed away in Montreal at the age of 114 years old when she passed away. That's what we mean by longevity risk.
Yeah, I wonder how many Stanley Cup victories from the Habs she experienced. You'd mentioned some of the initial Manual Life Income Plus had a 15 or a 30, it wasn't for life, and then they subsequently adjusted it.
Sure. So the early versions of these products were guarantees to pay you income for a fixed period of time. And what that did, in addition to giving you exposure to the equity markets, it protected you against a bear market. But the guarantee had a very finite ending. It was 30 years or 20 years, or depending on the type of guarantee, the Helios product from Desjardins, 14 years. The problem is that when you're looking at retirement, it could be longer than 14 or 20 or 25. That's the whole point of longevity risk. And what these products have done in the last 6 to 9 months is they've taken the guarantee from a finite maturity to potentially a lifetime maturity, and in some cases the maturity of the spouse as well. And that's an important piece of the retirement component, because that means that you're essentially creating a defined benefit pension. And for many years, defined benefit pensions had a higher coverage rate. More Canadians and certainly more Americans had defined benefit pensions. But in the last 10 to 20 years, the number of new defined benefit pension plans have basically gone to zero, and the number of private sector workers that are covered by defined benefit pensions is declining at a very rapid rate. How do you create something that's similar to what a defined benefit pension does? And that's what these products are trying to fulfill.
Now, you're a student of longevity. Have you seen any evidence that people are going to, the baby boom generation, for example, is going to live longer than their parents, like significantly, like 5, 10 more years?
Well, here's what we do know. When we map longevity, there's a very, very well-known researcher in Germany called Professor James Vaupel. And what he's done is he's found that in the last 160 years, consistently, women gain 3 months every year. So a baby girl born today has 3 more months of life expectancy compared to her sister born a year ago. Her sister that'll be born in a year from now will be 3 months healthier than the one born today. He found that this has been going on for the last 160 years. He doesn't think it's going to stop. His projection is that 6 decades from now, if you do the math, 60 years from now, life expectancy is 100 at birth versus the 80 that we see right now. So the evidence is that this is continuing to improve. The causes of death that used to kill us and essentially reduce reduce longevity are now being eliminated. So mortality rates from cancer have declined, survival rates have increased. All of these things point to a longer retirement period for people that have made it to retirement already.
The problem is you may be a long time alive, but very sick. This is why we have the critical illness insurance and long-term care insurance. Quick comment on those.
Absolutely, and I think that's why they're becoming more successful now, is people are realizing it used to be an illness like that would kill you within a few months, and there really was no need for funding to survive that. Now it's the other way around. You get it, there are medical expenses, and you may live 5 to 10 years afterwards. That's costly, and this is where critical illness is coming into play.
In fact, Christian Barnard, I believe, Dr. Barnard, at the first
South
heart
African,
transplant,
yeah.
That's what they discovered. Yeah, we did heart transplant. And now, oh my gosh, we have to pay for it.
Yeah, and his final point was that once he told them how much they had to pay for it, they'd get another heart attack.
Well, we could go on and on. I think all of these things and many more can be seen in the book, Are You a Stock or a Bond? And I look forward to reading it in depth as soon as I get my official copy.
Sure. Thank you.